So, hello everybody. I'm happy to be here, such a big audience, and I want to give you a quick introduction into what Internet of Things or Industrial Internet means to security, to cybersecurity at Siemens. I'm working now for Siemens in IT security for more than 20 years and had the opportunity to work in different organizations like enterprise communications, healthcare, or corporate information security office. And yeah, I think I learned a lot on this industrial space here. Now I'm responsible for PKI in industrial solutions for quite a while. So Siemens is in industrial infrastructures and components for more than 170 years, starting with telecommunication and power generation. Nowadays, most growing topics are digitalization in the industrial world. So the whole technology changed really a lot. So what does this digitalization really means? So we have a change from the number of devices interconnected, and that means the amount of data that is transmitted and processed really increases tremendously. So I don't know whether you know this term, so I didn't know it before, so brontobytes, so that's really a lot. So there is also a paradigm shift from today or yesterday. People were working on with applications to do something. And this changes to machines control other machines to do something. Systems with a lot of data in the background take decisions and control other systems to do something. So these are machine intelligence, big data, predictive decision making, and so on. And this really is something, yeah, that is what Scott said, the information age, probably. But what we also see is really an increase in attacks on such systems. So this Stuxnet was kind of a wake-up call to Siemens. I had the chance to follow these incidents on our internal IT in 2010 in the corporate information security office, but I also saw that a lot of initiatives started in that time to improve information security in products and solutions. And today, the number of and sophistication of attacks really increases, and what we see is it could be also worse. So there could be much more attacks, because attacks come with, on the one hand, the ability of the attacker. What is the attacker able to do on a system or solution? And on the other hand, on the motivation. Does he want to do something? Does he want to do harm to a system? And I think the ability is quite high, so attackers can do really a lot. But today, the motivation is relatively low. And we see, if it comes to military conflicts, then motivation increases a lot. And then we see more sophisticated and more painful attacks to infrastructures. And these kinds of infrastructures is finally the arena where Siemens is producing products too. So we have this process automation, factory automation, building technologies, energy automation, mobility services. And what even makes it more difficult to prevent attacks is that the systems more and more openly communicate and interact with each other, and that increases the challenge on how to protect this or secure such solutions, because we cannot do anything about the motivation of an attacker. So that is, yeah, maybe the politicians can do something about motivation. We as a technology manufacturer, we cannot do anything about motivation. But what we can do about is about the ability. So to increase security functionality in industrial products is what we can contribute to protect the whole thing as a manufacturer, and that's exactly what we do. And what the video finally was about, to motivate the divisions within the company to invest more in security technologies. Yeah, so digitalization is a really growing thing, and yeah, big drivers for digitalization is connectivity to manage all these increasing number of devices. But on the other hand, cybersecurity is an inherent part of digitalization, so the whole story of digitalization will not be successful if it not comes together with cybersecurity functionality, so in a protected way. So Siemens is producing products for critical infrastructures. A lot of critical infrastructures like railway traffic, like energy production, like healthcare systems. And a lot of our customers says to protect such critical, or to operate such critical infrastructures properly, we want to have the data processed internally. So the acceptance for cloud services in such critical infrastructures is limited. And therefore, we address these security requirements, and they are somehow different to what we see in the office world. So in the office world, IT security is a kind of a standard available for years. We see requirements in the industrial world that really differs from the office world, like these 20 years of lifetime of controllers in a factory. So that is really much more than what we see in offices. So typically in a data center, the racks are exchanged, let's say, every 5 years. What we also see is the patching cycle. These days, in office IT, this is done quite regularly. In industrial systems, this is a bit more tricky because a lot of these infrastructures have to fulfill regulatory issues. They have to be approved by official groups, and a change to the software is normally not allowed. So, because then the whole system has to be approved and tested properly again, and therefore the operator of such infrastructures really fear to quickly patch the systems. And yeah, that is a fact, so we have to address this. What does this mean? In the office IT, we have this CIA pyramid, all of you know that, with confidentiality, integrity, availability. So in the office world, the confidentiality is mostly the major requirement on IT security. In the industrial arena, this is different. So in the industrial arena, confidentiality is not that important. Availability of the system is most important, And integrity of the data is important. One simple example, if you have a railway track and you have a signal at the track, it is not important that you hide the fact that the signal is switched to red. So you can just stand by the track and have a look. So this is not, confidentiality is not an issue in this scenario. But it is an issue that this information to switch the signal to red is integrity protected. And it comes in time. So that is really important. And therefore, the CIA pyramid is somehow turned upside down in the industrial world. What does this mean to security requirements? So you can see here, confidentiality is more low and more high in the office IT. Integrity, availability is very high. And in the office world, it is somehow accepted that systems may not be available all the time. So a patching window and a downtime at a system is somehow accepted. But if you have a factory that is going 3 shifts, that has to be operated 24, 365 days a year, and a patching window and a downtime really costs enormous money. So that is not acceptable. So availability really is a big requirement here. Another interesting thing is safety and security. So in critical infrastructures, safety is an important issue, and safety is addressed quite differently than security. So safety really prevents the threats to humans, to human life, by technical systems. So the train should not harm the people driving on the train. So that's safety. Security is somehow different. So it prevents threats, attackers, due to technical systems. So, but in former times, safety was more or less addressed isolated, but nowadays, as systems get more and more interconnected, IT security comes into the game as a kind of enabler of this security, the safety features. So you could say you would have to put a box below here with a humans and environment that do attacks on the technical systems, which themselves implement this safety thing. So only a system that is not hacked can be operated properly and safely, so and fulfill the goal. That means safety in these days will not come without IT security. But what does these requirements, these different requirements to industrial systems really mean on PKI? So on a high level, it seems quite similar. You see some secure communication and you see some encryption of sensitive data. And if you go a bit deeper, you see, okay, this all is enabled with mutual authentication, some whole space authentication, or integrity protection. So this means entity or data origin authentication, which all can be implemented with PKI. In the internet, we see a lot of user ID password mechanisms. We also see PKI authentication, of course, but mostly we still see user ID password authentication. But when it comes to a machine-to-machine communication, this user ID password stuff is really hard. And finally, not solvable securely, because then the machine needs to have the user ID password somehow hard-coded, and we have a big hacking team in our department, and they say they will always get the password. if they spend enough effort on the device. So in this machine-to-machine world, PKI is today the only established technology to really provide this device authentication or service authentication, and also the data origin authentication. So what did we make out of this with a strategy we introduced, I introduced in the video? We said, okay, for a big company like Siemens is, with all these different technologies and products, it is really hard to expect that only consultancy is what the people in the company need, and then they will be able to implement everything themselves. So we saw the advantage and the synergies in offering a central service that offers centrally PKI services, and from our experience from the office world, we have an office PKI for 20 years now in the company running, and we also have these tokens to have our credentials, and therefore we had quite some know-how in our IT departments and a trust center. So we decided to set up a industrial PKI system that offers those specific PKI services that are needed for the industrial space, because the system we have for the office space is addressing those requirements very specifically. So we started this adventure in 2014, and as Scott said, make a planning and double the time, then you are quite well. We had quite a tough timeline too, and finally, as timelines shifted, we also managed to address the requirements of our first pilot user in the company. They had a product development and needed PKI services at a special point in time, and finally these timelines, we managed to match these timelines. Before that, we made market analysis and had a lot of product evaluation, and we also evaluated the Prime Key product suite and were very, very happy really with it, decided for it because of two reasons, I would say. The one is, of course, the product is really feature-rich and mature, but the other really important point is that Prime Key gave a commitment to further develop the system, and that we will have a partner who is also willing to implement those features that are specific to our use cases, to our industry. And that is really important for us, because when you set up a trust center with a PKI service, you don't exchange this after 5 years when the vendor is not that proper anymore. So you have to live with this decision for really a long time. And yeah, that's why I really like this strategy of Prime Key, to have, on the one hand, collect the input from the customers to provide roadmap-driven features, but on the other hand, also to have the freedom to discuss or decide to have some customer-driven features if they are very important from timeline or feature set to a specific customer. And so we managed to set up quite a good relationship, and yeah, as you see, we managed to set up the service and it is up and running, and we have several tenants on the system already, and this will grow. Yeah, so how does it look like? Probably quite simple to PKI guys, but we have a trust center. We had that already because we had this corporate PKI for 20 years up and running now, and we decided to have this OCSP responder and CMP gateway as those hosts that face the outside world. What outside world means is our factories and production lines and our big service operation projects. And of course we have a CA system with a root CA that is offline, as typically you have it, like this. So, okay, the formatting is a bit tricky. We already also started and not completed the signing service. So we see more and more need for central signing service, so better protection of signing keys and bigger throughput in signatures in our software development. And yeah, digitalization also means increase and more professional software development, of course. But we are not through with that, so this is, yeah, a bit grayed out. Yeah, and this is now what PrimeKey helped us with. So they really had the proper product portfolio on this architecture so that we could implement those systems in the way we wanted it, with a portfolio of one vendor who, yeah, is really very professional. And I want to say thank you to all the PrimeKey guys in this room. Yeah, you really do a great job. Thank you. Any questions? Yes, please.
Could you give some examples of the changes that you asked PrimeKey to make?
Yeah, so maybe I switch back. There was one thing with the CMP gateway. We said we don't want to have web services. We don't want to make use of web services in our PKI communication. I'm a fan of protocols like CMP, which was implemented by PrimeKey and a lot of other PKI product vendors. And we wanted to have a CMP communication hop by hop on this. And we discussed with PrimeKey how this CMP gateway as a front end, let's say, yeah, gateway terminates the communication from the outside, stores the CMP messages, and the CA grabs the CMP messages from the CMP gateway so that there is no inbound communication on that network edge. And yeah, that was one thing we discussed and PrimeKey implemented. Yeah.
For that, for the added security, is it not using web-based services?
Yeah, that is an increase in operational security for the trust center. Tomas, can you remember another point?
Yeah.
Exactly. We decided typically the CA system is a system who validates the requests. We said, okay, we want to have some parts of validation also on the front end. We also wanted to have kind of an authorization of the TLS client authentication here. We wanted to have some CMP message signature validation and authorization mechanism there too. And these were features PrimeKey really quickly implemented, and that gives us more trust also in the system.
I will say that for Dark Matter, we have similar architecture in terms of the services that you want to secure and having different zones and things that operate in different zones. And so this too was a requirement for us. And so as PrimeKey was obviously working on this for Siemens, we thought they were working on it just for us. Apparently they're working on it for a bunch of people. And but yeah, we have policies and we've called them areas of trust or rings of trust or communities of trust, whatever you want to call them, that we have set up, the policies that operate within those. In order to achieve that implementation of the policy, it actually required some changes to some of the things that are available in the appliances, because we also are using the appliances in most of our context. And so this too is sometimes very helpful.
Yeah. Other questions?
And how does that compare to the old CMP protocol in the HMPCA?
So the CMP protocol is used as is. So the messages are not altered or changed on the CMP gateway at all. They are just received, verified from the protection of the CMP message, and then stored, so that the CA system can process them further. So there is no change in the protocol. It's more that, yeah, we have a front end that makes some pre-decisions.
What is the problem with sans-serif? Why no front and line?
Pardon?
What is the problem with sans-serif?
The problem, there's no problem. It's just work in progress. So it's not there yet. We are working on it to implement this.
Did you run into any technical limitations on the industrial system not being powerful enough to support e-links or hash functions?
No, not yet, but things change. In a lot of devices, we make use of elliptic curve cryptography because they have the limited or reduced requirements on computation and so on. And there is some change in this arena, which curves need to be supported and which key lengths need to be supported. And yeah, I'm pretty hopeful that PrimeKey will follow these developments to offer also future developments in elliptic curve cryptography. But of course, also HSMs need to implement these. But I'm, yeah, quite optimistic. Coming to specific certificate profiles or certificate extensions, proprietary extensions, that is what we like about the PrimeKey product, that we have quite a lot of freedom to implement also, yeah, very proprietary extensions to certificate profiles. Even dynamic things that when a request comes in, some content is injected dynamically on the CA system. So,
what does the local registration authority look like? What do you use as the local registration?
That is some, let's say, homegrown system. We don't have off-the-shelf system because these local registration authorities typically implement the use cases and the business workflows of that specific unit that is really needed at that point in the certificate management flow. So yeah, we could of course think about having a product or something like, but the requirements from the guys who, for example, implement factory IT, factory automation IT, they have quite some their own ideas on how such a system looks like, and yeah, therefore, today at least we go with our own system.
Everything on the left box, is that on-site, customer site, or is that something that you guys are hosting?
That is in our data center, and yeah, that is centrally hosted, and these are then on-site.
On the customer site?
Not yet, not yet, as we focus on our factories. This could also mean a third-party manufacturer. And this for the service operation business, this is today at least not at the customer site, but in our service operation center to make the operation of that solution.
Yes. What seems to harden their key and trust in the device?
That is more or less the content in the video with this trust anchor stuff. In that video, trust anchor doesn't mean like root CAs, trusted root CAs, what are also regarded as trust anchors, at least for me. There, the trust anchor meant some hardware protection of keys.
If you roll out this globally, does your trust center, does it need to replicate in different geographical zones, or can you operate?
That could happen, but that is not needed now. So we are in the ramp-up phase. As I showed, we have some tenants, but we extend to other geographical regions, and we will make our experiences. One approach for that could also be to have a kind of a batch processing mechanisms to not issue the certificates on the fly in the production, but to collect all the requests from the devices and send them to a central system, get the results back, and then complete the production. But this really interacts quite a lot with the production planning guys. So we have quite a lot of rounds and discussions, workshops with the production planning people. What are the requirements of the PKI system on the enrollment, and what are the needs of the production planning?
I've seen the logo Frankie on the top of the root CA.
Yes.
You say that it's offline. It's fully offline, or yes. The keys have been generated? The keys have not been generated by the HBCA?
The root CA keys are not generated by EGBCA anyhow. They are generated by an HSM. So this comes with proper inventory. So if you properly store your device identities and device production data in a, let's say, integrity protected database system, then that is the maximum you can do today to handle such an issue later on. So if you know which public key, which private key is out there in the field, what are the IDs, then you at least can address that and address that maybe with a firmware patch. We have mechanisms, procedures in place, how to patch the controllers, how to communicate with the customers.
The what?
How long do you think it will take to switch to a new cryptographic algorithm in your system?
Thomas? it's an update, probably. It's an update to the system. Of course, such an infrastructure is not that easy to update. And then you have to support these new algorithms in the registration authorities. And of course, products need to support this too. The HSMs need to support it. So it's not easy, but with elliptic curve cryptography, the technology or the mathematics behind is more or less same. So you change parameters. So yeah, it depends on what you want to change to. If you come to complete new technology, it's more R&D effort needed. Yeah. Other questions?
I have one more, but it might be a silly question. Are you envisioning, or are you implementing a system where it's an individual private key for every device, or yes, one private key for a family of devices?
No, every single device.
Great.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.